Yesterday, the announcement was made of the sacking of 750 steel workers from the massive steelworks in Port Talbot in South Wales. This is a cruel blow, which, taken into consideration the accumulated effects of these sackings on Port Talbot, which is dependent on steel, it used to be known in my day as the City of Steel. This represents potentially not just the potential destruction of the steel industry in the United Kingdom, not just in Wales, but also the destruction of an entire community. It's a severe blow. I remember when I was a youngster in the 1950s when they opened Margam, as the steelworks was then known. It was then known in Port Talbot. And workers were flocking to work there, young people, workers from Swansea, from my own town, just down the road from Port Talbot, earning £20 a week, which was a lot of money in those days. And at that time, I well remember there was an atmosphere of hope in the future and so on. Now, all that has been destroyed, has been shattered overnight by this devastating blow, which represents just one additional step in the wholesale wrecking and destruction of British industry. I note, for example, one worker that was interviewed on the TV last night made a very good question. He said, look, this government, they're prepared to save the banks. By the way, it wasn't a Tory government, it was a Labour government that did that. Prepared to save the banks, but they're not prepared to save British industry, and that's what it boils down to. Now, what was interesting is the reason that they gave for this terrible catastrophe. They blamed it on adverse market conditions and cheap Chinese imports of cheap imported Chinese steel. Now, that goes, in a sense, to the heart of the problem, because they never cease to tell us that we're part of a global economy. It's all the fault, apparently, of the global economy. Yes, but what does it mean? Globalization, which, by the way, is not a new thing. It was, first of all, explained by Marx and Engels, the inevitability that the capitalist system would develop a massive world market. And nowadays, of course, Marx's prediction has been shown to be absolutely correct in a laboratory fashion. Nowadays, at the present time, the 21st century, the most important aspect of the epoch in which we live is the crushing domination of the world market. And the world market, the capitalist world market at this moment in time, is in severe difficulty, severe problems. You saw that already on the 1st of January, the new year, the year of our Lord 2016, began with what? A massive crisis on the stock exchange, on all the stock markets of the world, starting in China. There were heavy falls, severe falls. And that's continued, by the way. I believe it's correct to say that since the 1st of January, the last figure I saw, is that the global markets have fallen by 7.1%. That's a severe fall. And this volatility, this turbulence on world stock markets reveals something, it shows something. And what it shows fundamentally is the nervousness, an extreme nervousness now of the capitalists, of the bourgeois, of the investors, in the future of the world economy, in the future of capitalism, if you like. These falls are a massive vote of no confidence, in effect, of the bourgeois in their own system. Yes, and at the heart of this panic, it is, you can't describe it with any other words, at the heart of this crisis is the crisis of China now, the crisis of Chinese capitalism. China, for the last decades, has now decisively entered into the capitalist world economy. It's an integral part, it's a vital part, in point of fact, of the capitalist world economy. And of course, for a time, they benefited from both the Chinese bourgeois and the Western capitalists also benefited from this. I remember about, 25, 30 years ago, perhaps, 25 years ago, I had a discussion with a Spanish comrade, a Spanish friend, who had illusions. He'd swallowed the line of the bourgeois propaganda that Asia was going to save capitalism. Yes, he said, look at China, look at Asia. And it is true, undoubtedly true, that the entry into the world market, the capitalist world market, of a huge country of over a billion people with colossal potential of productive development was undoubtedly a major factor in the last period. One can say, I think without exaggeration, that it was China that saved the world capitalist system from the slump of 2000 and the crisis of 2008, developing into an all-out depression on the lines of the 1930s. I think that's a fair comment. China did, prior to that, for the last 20 or 30 years, China's offered a big potential for investment, for huge profits, of course, at the expense of the Chinese workers. You mustn't forget that. The terrible conditions of the Chinese working class, working in Dickensian conditions as in the workers, like the workers of in the days of Marx, or the days of Charles Dickens. It's colossal exploitation, extracting surplus value on a massive scale. And on the basis of foreign investment, massive foreign investment, the Chinese capitalists were able to erect big new factories with the most modern technology and with a colossal productive capacity. So that all of this, of course, combined, did assist, it did open up new markets and so on, acted as a stimulus, acted as a cushion, preventing world capitalism from collapsing altogether. Yes, that's all that is true. But you know, dialectics tells us, Marxism explains, that sooner or later things turn into their opposite. And China now, far from being the motor force of the world economy, which it was, for the whole of the last at least two decades, the motor force, the main motor force, perhaps the only motor force of the world economy, has now turned into its opposite. It's a colossal drain, a drag on world capitalism. It's actually exacerbating all the contradictions that exist. Now, if one takes China alone, the stock market crisis, incidentally, in early January and to the present time, started in China, with huge falls on the Chinese stock market, stock exchange. So severe were these falls, they're quite unexpected, they weren't expecting that. So severe were the falls that they even had to cancel, had to switch off a circuit breaker, I think it's called, which they'd installed, precisely for the purpose of limiting crises on the stock exchange. They had to cancel it because the falls were so severe that this apparatus couldn't cope with it. Now that's a warning of things to come. Now the real reason for the crisis in China and the real reason for capitalist crisis in general, as a general rule, some clever people in the universities and some clever so-called Marxists try to call this into question, now raising all kinds of questions of the falling rate of profit and other matters which I don't propose to go into at this moment in time. But let's be clear about it, let's call a spade a shovel. It's an elementary principle of Marxism. Marx explained this 1,000 times. Engels explained it 1,000 times. That the ultimate cause of every genuine, every real capitalist crisis is overproduction, my friends. Overproduction. This is a word that the bourgeois don't like to use, and some so-called Marxists, I'm astonished to say, don't like to use either. But it's a fact. In fact, last night on the news, Channel 4 News, for the first time ever I heard one of these newscasters use the word. You can see he was struggling with it. He finally managed to cough it up in bits, you know. He uttered the word, the unpronounceable word, overproduction. Yes, China, believe it or not, you know what it is? It's suffering from overproduction of steel. They showed on the television cameras relating to this problem in Port Talbot. They showed in China. Huge quantities, hundreds of tons of steel, which is rusting, literally stockpiled in China. At the same time, the Chinese, never mind about Port Talbot, they're very desperately sorry for those fellow countrymen of mine who suddenly find themselves without work and without prospects. But in China, it's even worse. Thousands of workers, thousands of Chinese steel workers have been laid off. Chinese unemployment is soaring, as a matter of fact. It's not revealed in the statistics because most of these are migrants from the villages, the peasants, and they made an employment. They're expected to go back to the villages to, I don't know what they're supposed to do, to eke out miserable living, scratching potatoes or yams or rice or whatever they produce. On semi-starvation levels. That they're not included in the figures. Therefore, that's how they get around the question of unemployment. But unemployment in China is increasing. So are strikes. There have been a mass of strikes. Many strikes are not, of course, reported. Because strikes are illegal in socialist China. They still got the impudence to call that socialism. Strikes are illegal, if you please, in a socialist country. And yet mass strikes are taking place against factory closures for wage increases and so on and so forth. And that's something which you should watch for the future. You see, as long as China was going forward, and it was going forward, no question about that. China was massively going forward. Some people try to deny that. I don't understand this approach. The Chinese industry, Chinese economy is massively going forward. And they were churning out, I pointed this out to my Spanish friend 20 odd years ago. I said, well, you're right, in the short run that may be the case. But you must answer the following question. China is building up a colossal productive base, able to produce a mass of cheap commodities, not just toys and ladies' underwear as in the past, but high-tech goods, as a matter of fact, steel and other things, high-tech goods, television sets, component parts. You won't find a single television set or camera or telephone in your house that hasn't got a large amount of components that are made in China. A colossal amount of goods are being made, yes, but where are they going to be sold? That's the question I asked my Spanish friend 20 odd years ago. They can't be absorbed in China, the consumption power of the Chinese masses is too small. And therefore China has to export. That was okay as long as the world was expanding up to 2008 and even beyond that, on the basis of credit and so on and so forth. There was a market, somewhere to export to. Yes, but no more. That's finished, the game is up. The consumption is falling in Europe, in America, particularly Europe and America. They're the key areas for consumption in the world economy. So where's China going to export to? Maybe they can export to the moon or the planet Pluto. I don't know. They certainly can't export to anywhere on this planet. And now, of course, they're faced with an extreme dilemma. The latest figures I've seen for December of 2015 indicate a sharp fall, not just in Chinese growth. And by the way, Chinese growth, even if one accepts the official figures, and they've been called into question by quite a few people, they're not sure that these figures are correct that they're issuing. But the official figure says the Chinese economy grew by last year, 2016, by 6.9%. Now that might seem a lot to you compared to the miserable growth rates in Europe, in Britain and America and so on. Yes, but from a Chinese point of view, even that figure is a disaster. It's down, by the way. It was the year earlier, 2014, the equivalent period, it was up by 7.3%. So that's a decline. Decline in growth. Yes, but you see, the Chinese authorities themselves have stated in the past that China requires a rate of growth, an annual rate of growth of 8% just to maintain the present levels, just to keep up with population growth, put it that way. They need 8%. They've not got 8%. Even on their own figures, they've got 6.9%. And some Western analysts have said that it may be as low as 3%. They don't believe these figures which are issued by the Chinese state, which present a very favorable picture. And therefore, you can see the reason for these strikes and also peasant unrest, demonstrations and so on, which are the contradictions have been built up now for decades in China. And now they will undoubtedly come to the fore. But the main consequence that I needed to deal with today is what effects this will have on the world economy. Well, you see it in my own country, in Wales, in Port Talbot, this terrible tragedy which has befallen the people of Port Talbot. And that's not the end of the story. They're already predicting, the trade unions are predicting, I think that's correct, that unless the government does something, and the government, this Tory government, shows no signs, of course, of doing anything. It's quite correct what was said. They're the bankers' friends, the friends of the parasites, not the friends of the productive forces, of productive industry, certainly not of the working class. This could really mark the final nail in the coffin of British industry that was already destroyed, largely destroyed by the previous Tory government of Margaret Thatcher. Yes, this butchery will continue because prices are falling. Now here you have a paradox. Steel prices have fallen massively on world markets. Not just steel prices, but the prices of many commodities. Oil prices, oil now has fallen, which was what, about $140 a barrel it was at one stage. Now it's fallen below $30 a barrel, and some analysts predicted it'll fall as low as $10 a barrel. Now, you might think this is a good thing. I mean, the motorists are pleased. Why the motorists are pleased, I don't know. when the price of a litre of petrol falls below a pound, people are cheering. Well, not so. That doesn't reflect at all the real collapse in the price of oil prices. It's highway robbery, even despite the reduction. But you think people would be cheerful. You think that would be a positive thing where prices are falling. Normally it would be. It isn't so now. The falling price of steel, of iron, for example, I noticed just collapsed to a record low price, of commodities in general. It hits countries which is used to export to China. Let me put it this way. You see, it's not difficult to explain. It's not rocket science. It's really very simple. If Europe and America are not consuming, they can't consume because of the high levels of debt inherited from the previous crisis. If Europe and America are not consuming, China cannot produce, as simple as that. And if China cannot produce, countries like Brazil, Argentina, Australia, which were exporting their raw materials to China, cannot produce, also cannot produce. Therefore, you have the makings of a colossal world crisis and a downward spiral. That's why they're not cheering the falling prices. The falling price is just a symptom of a disease, of a sickness of the world economy. And it will lead to a downward spiral, which probably will end in a slump. And this slump, by the way, could be worse than the slump of 2008. Why do I say that? Well, all the indexes point in the direction of a severe slump, even in the course of this year. And the difference with 2008 is this. The capitalist economists are seriously concerned. They're in a state of panic about this because they can't see how they can get out of a slump. Now, there are certain mechanisms which they can use to get out of a slump. I'll state what they are. Decrease the rate of interest and increase state expenditure. That's the traditional Keynesian model, beloved of all social democrats and reformists. Yes, but those instruments are no longer available to them because they've already used them up in the previous crisis. How can you reduce, for example, the rate of interest when it's already zero, close to zero? Unless you have a negative rate of interest, which is an interesting proposition. And how can you increase state expenditure when all governments are attempting to cut state expenditure precisely to reduce the debts produced by these colossal handouts to the banks in the previous period? So this is a very serious scenario. What's the role of China in this? Well, China has got to export or die. That still remains the position. They're exporting steel. That's the problem in South Wales at the moment, in Port Talbot. The Chinese steel, there's no way that the British steel industry can compete with those low prices. In effect, the Chinese are dumping, and they will continue to dump the excess produce on the world market. Therefore, instead of helping the world capitalist system, which they did in the past, China is now exacerbating all the contradictions of overproduction, because there's massive overproduction in China itself. If one adds to that the fact that the Chinese currency, the yuan, has been tied in a way, partially tied at least, to the American dollar, which is soaring. The Chinese bureaucracy, now the Chinese ruling class, if you like, now, are determined to push the yuan down. That's the only way they can increase their exports, by decreasing the yuan. Now this again is dangerous stuff, a very dangerous situation. You see, what people don't generally realize, it was precisely protectionism and competitive devaluations which turned the 1929 slump in Wall Street into the Great Depression. And that's the scenario which scares them now. The Chinese will go down the road, I don't doubt this, you watch this space. In the next few months they're going to devalue the yuan, and that will trigger a whole series of competitive devaluations in Asia, but also in America and Europe and so on. You think the Americans and Europeans are going to allow a constant stream of Chinese goods being cheap, Chinese produce being dumped on their markets? And by the way, devaluation is a form of exporting unemployment. That's the purpose of it. Chinese will try to get around their problems by dumping their goods, which of course will inevitably lead to the erection of trade barriers. It's only a matter of time. And that in turn can be the end of the whole process of globalization, which has dominated capitalism for the last 20 or 30 years. And therefore, a very turbulent period now opens up, economically, financially, in terms of money, and also, of course, in terms of the class struggle, which will undoubtedly put on the order of the day, including in China, by the way, the prospect of social explosions, and ultimately, the idea of socialist revolution must be put on the order of the day as the only way out of this terrible catastrophe of capitalist crisis.